Pro Life Berks on BCTV is underwritten by Tom Schaefer RV Superstore.
Good evening and welcome to Pro Life Berks on this beautiful Monday evening. Tonight we have special guest Rick Crump, founder and executive director of Kinetic Faith. Rick is going to go on about tell us about what he does. And we have Marlene Downing from Susan B. Anthony, Pro Life America Group. Rick is going to start us off with talking about, as we just come off of Father's Day yesterday, we're going to talk about fatherhood and the pro-life movement and different aspects of that since we, in conjunction with Father's Day yesterday. And then Marlene will speak about what Susan B. Anthony does, and we'll go on from there. Hope you enjoy the evening.
It's great to be here. Thank you for having us.
Thank you for coming.
Coming off of Father's Day, I can't imagine my life without my sons.
My wife
Tammy and I raised four sons.
Four sons.
full of what would now be considered toxic masculinity, which is a whole topic itself. We're very proud of them. And, you know, sitting with my father yesterday and my three brothers, and then my sons came over just to see three generations there. Very moving, very grateful for that experience. And in every single case, and my sons are now becoming fathers, in every single case, none of us can imagine our lives without our children. And so this movement is near and dear to us. We love working with Marlene and others that we're gonna take this battle in Pennsylvania on to eliminate abortion. It's really a scourge of our society, isn't it? It's such a blight and indictment on us. As I think about fatherhood, I think that we were just talking before the show, there's clearly a relationship between young ladies in bad relationships when they don't have good role models as fathers in their lives, right? And I think there's this misnomer that fathers are meant to be your buddy.
Yes.
They're meant to be your pal. And nothing more further could be from the truth. I told my sons, as we were raising them, we had a lot of slogans, a lot of sayings in our house. And one of them was that my job is to put myself out of a job. That my job is to raise you up in such a way that you're no longer going to need us. You're going to be a strong, and I did have this statement too for my kids that you don't become a man when you're dependent. I think we all know that.
Right.
But you also don't become a man when you're independent.
Right. Mm-hmm.
You become a man when you're dependable.
Right.
And that's really what daughters and sons need from their fathers.
Right.
And if we had more fathers that would be that dependable role and that role of discipline, that role of providing and protecting, that role that says, look, my job is to make you be able to stand on your own two feet and make good, healthy choices. I can't help but think there'd be healthier relationships out there today. Is that fair to say?
Oh, you're absolutely right. And I think what people are missing in society is their roles. Mm-hmm. The role of a father, the role of a mother, the role of a man and a woman, because they are significant roles and they are separate. And what happens is once you take charge of one role or the other, then you eliminate the other role. So you really have to really define those roles. And people nowadays have gotten into the case where they don't want us to define them.
Yeah. Actually,
it's almost taboo to define them.
I don't know if you knew this, but we teach this in one of our seminars, is that when you look at the Supreme Court justice case about homosexual marriage, it's actually in the writings there that they say there is now no acknowledged difference between men and women. And so therefore it doesn't matter. And they cite there's no difference between fathers and mothers, there's no difference between husbands and wives, and because there's now no recognized difference in these roles, it doesn't matter which one you marry. That was a key foundational part of their decision at the Supreme Court.
Yeah.
And to your point, I can't help but think how that affects a child.
Right.
And it devalues life. I grow up in a home where there's no recognized difference between my parents and there's nothing that we're supposed to aspire to, and now I'm going to go have a relationship and it's no wonder people will not take responsibility for those actions now.
Right, exactly. It's confusing.
It is, it's very confusing. And again, I understand that the hormones are running strong and that people are tempted sexually, But I think what we're here to talk about is after that decision happens, you know, after that pregnancy happens, it's a human life involved now. And you have to be emotionally and mentally prepared to take responsibility for that. And that, and a huge part of that, I lay right at the Father's feet. It was my job to make sure my sons were ready for this world and that they were ready to be dependable for their wives and children.
Right.
Yeah, I mean, it all comes down to fatherhood. It really does. And I think a lot of the men that do choose abortion for their child, or they might not be choosing abortion, they might be walking alongside of their significant other to have an abortion. But the reason why they're doing this so willingly is because they're afraid of fatherhood as well.
Yeah, tell me if you think I'm wrong here, but I think there's two types of men in this situation. There's the man who's heartbroken because he has no say.
That's right.
And he wants to keep that child because he knows that child is his and he's willing to step up. Mm-hmm. And then you have that other man who's, oh, this is my out.
Yeah.
This lets me off the hook.
Right.
And he's more than happy to go help enable the abortion.
Yeah.
And
he's not equipped to provide him for protection.
Right, if there was ever a good indicator of which was a good man and which wasn't, mm-hmm. is that fair?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely. But in both cases, we find that they are scared to speak up.
Yeah.
They're afraid to speak up. And especially in the case of the man that wants to have the child, to have their baby, they have bought into the lie that it's a woman's body, it's her choice. But again, we're not talking about her body. We're speaking of the life of the child. And that's really what's really missing here is the definition of what is human life.
Right.
You know, when does it start? And it starts at conception. And many people don't have that view, but it's not up to people, it's up to science. I mean, it's up to God. But because a lot of people, you know, may not believe in God, but if they don't believe in God, we know they believe in science because they've been, you know, just pushing this science thing forever. Well, science says that life starts at conception.
Mm. Isn't it the psalmist that said you were fearfully and wonderfully made? And the more we find out through science about life, the harder it is to deny the existence of a creator. And the more you realize, wow, it really is a life. I mean, the higher our technology gets, the more we're capable of seeing, like the heartbeat.
And the DNA.
Right? And the DNA.
Yeah.
And you start to understand that wow, there is a human being growing there.
Mm-hmm. Yes, the heartbeat starts so sooner than that, because the science, the equipment that they have, they can hear this heartbeat earlier than they could years
ago.
Even 30, 40 years ago, the equipment that they have, the sonograms and all, you can hear it a lot quicker. Even from the time I had a sonogram with my first son, it's a lot more refined and a lot easier to define that as a child growing. So,
you know, I think one of the things that we used to raise our sons with was the notion, we never asked our sons, what would a Christian do, believe it or not, being a strong Christian. We asked our sons, what would a Christian man do? We wanted to affirm their identity that God had given them and to raise them up in the way they should go, right? And I would encourage parents today to take that approach with your daughter and your son, is raise them, because in that moment of truth when they're tempted, whether it's before sex or after conception, they're going to be very tempted to take the easy way out. And it takes a strong, responsible person to make the right decision. And I would encourage you throughout their life, as they're young growing up, to challenge them. What would a Christian young lady do in this point? What would a Christian young man do at this point? Help them affirm their identity. And that will, I think, obviously help them make better choices as they go throughout. But if they are tempted and they fall into that temptation and they find themselves in a hard decision and tempted for abortion, I know from experience, seeing the hard decisions my sons have had to make in different areas, that raising them that way made a difference.
Mm-hmm.
It helped affirm, as a Christian young man, I need to, or I'm faced with, or I have to. They didn't always make the right choice, but you could tell it weighed on them, and when they made the wrong choice, they came back from it. And this is, what bigger decision could there be than to decide the life of another human being?
Right. Rick, why don't you tell us a little bit about Kinetic Faith and what you do to help interpose upon situations like this.
Yeah, thank you. So we use the word, we use the phrase, the doctrinal phrase, interposition.
Right.
And the layman's term is to stand in the gap.
Right.
And essentially, it's based on Ezekiel 22, when it's interesting. In Ezekiel 22, you had the prophet declaring how the three power bases that God had ordained were all corrupted. The family had been corrupted, the government had been corrupted, and the church had been corrupted. I don't know, does that sound like anything close to today, right?
Sounds familiar.
And he said his wrath was going to come, and he said, I looked for a man to stand in the gap,
right?
And I found none, and therefore my wrath is going to come out. And our premise is this, is that as Christians especially, we are to stand in the gap, we are to interpose, we are to call the culture to reject evil, and that is an influential role of being salt and light. So what we do is we train and equip people in their community to be able to make that moral apologetic, that moral argument to do away with evil, such as if there's pornography in your children's library. Mm-hmm. As Christians, we should be equipped and confident that we can persuade the community to want to do away with that, and to put pressure on their school boards and whatnot.
Right.
So we help organize and mobilize communities that want to take on these, they call them social issues or political issues, but they're really issues of good and evil.
Right.
And it's so prevalent in today's society.
Boils down to.
So that's what we do, and we stick around to providing the coaching and the support, the technology that they need to get the job done. And our goal ultimately, though, is to really see the church take this role back.
Right.
That what we do at Kinetic Faith used to be owned by the church. The churches were the ones.
Why do you think they lost that role?
Well, I'll tell you, the two most common reasons we have found for the rejection of the mission of interposition is, number one, they think it's different than the gospel. They say the gospel is intercession and evangelism. We're supposed to pray for them, and we're supposed to tell them to accept Christ. But we say there's a third ring to that diagram, and that's interposition. That's what Christ did when he walked the earth for 3.5 years.
Right.
So, and I find it interesting that the less we interpose, the less we're evangelizing,
right,
and the less we're praying. Pastors are having a hard time getting their own people to show up for prayer meetings. And I say, well, that's because you're not interposing. You've lost your own confidence.
Right.
The second thing we find that the reason why they don't interpose is there is a end of world mindset today that we're consumed with, that we've somehow bought into this lie that this is all supposed to happen, it's preordained, and that what's bad for the world is good for us as Christians. And that is not loving our neighbor. It's up to God to determine when the end is.
Right.
But until then, we have a job to do to be salt and light in our communities. And there's a lot more I could go into on that, but that's really, to answer your question, the two things that have held the churches back is they bought into this notion that interposition is out of the scope of the gospel, and they bought into this notion that this is all supposed to happen, and we're supposed to keep our mind our own business and keep our heads down. And I say to people, that is exactly why we have the world we have today. And we really actually need to God's looking for us to stand in the gap, and we're not. And it says, so I brought my wrath out. I poured my wrath out.
And that's what's happening.
Because there was nobody in my people.
Right.
And I remind people, he says that if my people who are called by my name humble themselves and pray and turn from their wicked ways, then I will heal their land, right?
Right.
And so our mission field is the church, to call the church back to that mission of interposition and as an act of repentance.
And how can lay people like us here and people watching tonight, how can we encourage our pastors or our churches to do that?
Here's a layman's way of asking and challenging your pastor about this is what do we measure ourselves by? Are we measuring ourselves by butts in the seats, or are we measuring ourselves by the impact we make in our community?
Right.
Because the community is every church's mission field.
Right.
And it's not just about how many people made decisions for Christ, but can we convince our community to reject evil? Can we simply, if we cannot simply convince our community to reject pornography in their children's library, what influential good are we doing?
Mm-hmm.
And watch the pastor's response. If he wants to give the excuse of politics and stuff, don't settle for that.
Yeah.
Press the issue.
Yeah.
But
even this separation of church and state excuse, I hear that, coming from.
It's
go ahead.
So sad, because it's almost an excuse.
Right.
It is very much an excuse.
Right. I mean, really, you have church, you go into church and you do the singing, you do the worship, and then you leave.
Right.
That's not what he told us to
do.
Right.
We have a whole mission when we leave.
He said to go.
Yes,
right?
Amen.
So if we actually are to go, then when we go, we have to have a message. And that message has got to be truth.
Right.
Like, we can't stand on anything else. Like, we
right.
can't give out you know, gift baskets and, you know, try to bring people and lure them in and have smoke and mirrors. No, we have to come with the truth, and we have to bring the truth in love. And that's what's missing.
Well, that's a good lead for you to tell us about Susan B. Anthony, then, how that got started and how it is what it is today.
So Susan B. Anthony List was started by Marjorie Dannenfelser. She is a beautiful woman that just had the mission to change the laws that are in place on abortion. And in Pennsylvania, currently, we are, you know, just knocking doors, and we're changing hearts and you know, just speaking to people at the doors and meeting them where they are, because not everybody has the same opinion. Not everybody believes that life starts at conception. Not everybody, you know, believes in Christ. So when we go to the door, we speak to them about just what's going on. So basically what's happening is that there is a late-term abortion that is going on at, you know, even later than 15 weeks, but we know at 7 weeks, then, or 6 weeks, there is a heartbeat. We know that at 15 weeks, a baby can suck its thumb and has organs. Everything is fully developed, but this is a time when a baby can be aborted. And people, they don't think of it like that. They don't have, like, the thought process to really process, you know, what abortion is. All they hear is that a convenience that happens for a mother that might not be prepared for motherhood is being taken away. So those are things that we kind of educate at the door, and we speak to people about infanticide. So what happens in infanticide is that when a baby is born alive in a botched abortion, which happens, you know, and a lot of politicians really want this up until the moment of birth, abortion on demand. You know, when a baby is born alive, they leave them, you know, and some states that these have laws have been passed, they leave them to die. And this is happening in our actually right here, you know, in our country. And when we think about it, it's really sad, because it's like these things are happening in countries that, you know, we would expect them to happen in, like China and North Korea, but not in America. You know, we wouldn't expect that to happen here, but because we're so advanced, like, why would this happen here? And it's because we've allowed this to happen. The church has not stepped up.
Right.
And so that's what Susan B. Anthony List does, is we advocate for the laws of, you know, just letting people know that we're not going to stand for it. We're here to change those laws. We're here to change those laws by, you know, selecting the correct candidates to represent the laws that should be in place.
And now we have a big abortion decision coming forth with Roe versus Wade being overturned. So you want to elaborate on that some too?
So Roe versus Wade, I guess the most important thing is to educate people on what Roe versus Wade is not.
Right.
So Roe versus Wade is not going to end abortion completely. And that's something that people don't really truly understand. And that's why there's so much of an uproar with the people, is because they believe the lies of the media. They believe lies that they hear without educating themselves first on what Roe versus Wade actually stands for. So what Roe versus Wade did was it actually stood as a barricade for the states to be able to come to their own consensus state by state. And that's what's going to happen when Roe versus Wade is overturned. It's going to come back to the states so that the consensus of the people can be determined through their legislators. And so that's why it's important for us to get behind our legislators who are pro-life and select them so that they can, you know, pass these laws that will support life and save lives, because that is so important. And in Pennsylvania, we really definitely need a governor and a senator that is, you know, because these elections are coming up in November. We need them, you know, and we need them to be in place so that we can get the right laws in place to save lives.
Yeah.
Can I make a quick observation, though?
Sure.
To your point, I'm so aggravated by states, especially the churches.
Yeah.
That say, well, Roe v. Wade prevents us from doing something. Roe v. Wade prevents us from doing federal law.
Mm-hmm.
if you think about what caused this whole case to come about in the first place, where they're going to question whether or not the states have a right to decide this for themselves, was that a state did step up.
Yeah.
Mississippi stepped up and took on abortion and made the courts take this decision on. Thank God, if they hadn't had the leadership and the people had the courage of their convictions to take this issue on, we wouldn't have this case before the Supreme Court today. If everybody had just decided, oh, Roe v. Wade is it, and we can't do anything, our hands are tied, we wouldn't even be here debating this. But thank God some people stepped up in Mississippi, challenged it, and said, we're taking out abortion in Mississippi. Of course, the left says you can't do that. But now it's going to lead to what we hope is a decision that will turn the decision back to the states. And it started, here's my point, it started when people said it couldn't be done.
Right.
That's what caused the get the ball rolling in the first place. Amen?
Right,
and that's what we really want to see from the churches and the Christian community, to step up and start doing things that they're stepping back from.
So I would even venture to say that it started with people like you. It started with people with a vision who understood that it only takes that one person to stand up for the right thing and to put something in place. So it actually started with, you know, the thought
taking
of
the battle
your,
on.
Right, to take it on. And that's what we have to
Amen.
Be. We definitely have to be bold in this hour. Because
and mobilize people to join the troop and get in the troops and get in the trenches and fight this evil.
Yes.
That's pretty much what we're up against now with, you know, a lot of different things, but specifically abortion.
Yeah, absolutely.
Can I share that quick story about the event we were at together?
Of course.
Yeah.
You know, I had the privilege of moderating a Susan B. Anthony event, and you were on the panel. And by the way, you have an amazingly powerful testimony. I would encourage folks to follow you and to hear your testimony. And I remember, basically, I had three questions that night. The first question was, why did you choose the path you chose to be, because everyone fights abortion in their own way, right?
Right.
Second question was, what would it take to overturn abortion in Pennsylvania? And third question was, what do we do in a post-abortive world to support pregnancy centers? And it was during the second question that you said something. And it really was moving to me, because I don't even remember what it was that caused me to ask you the follow-up question, because what happened next was so profound. Mm-hmm. But I said, you know, what would your advice be to the people in the audience tonight to get their churches involved to support this? And you kind of looked at me and said, wow, getting the churches involved. And you shook your head, like, what a daunting task. Mm-hmm. And there was this collective groan in the audience. And I stopped the meeting, if you recall, and I said, did you guys understand what just happened there? We're talking about getting the churches involved to save millions of babies' lives, and you all groaned at the notion of the heavy lift it would take to get your churches involved, and they all started nodding.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And I thought, I just want to say to the audience tonight, that's got to stop. That's got to change. That is horribly sinful of us if we're not actively pursuing the end of abortion at all means. And at Kinetic Faith, we have ways that we can help you go about doing that if you want to contact us. But I'm not trying to promote Kinetic Faith, but I'm just trying to say that that was a very powerful moment that I thought, and it was so authentic, that it really spoke volumes about what we need to do with our hearts and minds to turn them back to Christ to go save babies' lives.
Yeah.
And that should be a mission for men, too. For
Amen.
Fathers.
Men should Absolutely. Be, the men's yeah. ministries, the men's ministry should be preparing for this battle right now.
Right.
I've led plenty of men's groups and been involved with men's ministries, and I can tell you the stuff they're talking about with the personal purity and all that, that's great, but they're not preparing men for battle, and they need to be preparing for men to go outside of these men groups to go lead this battle.
Right.
I think when we talk about men, we definitely have to speak to the fact that the lead of the church is the pastor.
Yes.
Right.
You know, and he has, you have pastors, you have to lead. You
Amen.
Have to lead your flock
right.
because you are responsible for them ultimately.
Right.
And so much can happen under your leadership where you can change the hearts and minds. And I know that in an abortion situation where you believe that, this is what I believe that pastors think when they don't speak on abortion. Some of them believe that they're hurting people in their congregation. Some
right,
of
they're
them
insulting
believe,
them.
Yeah, some of them believe that if they say something in their congregation that they're going to lose members,
right?
Which is just not.
Can I say something about that, though?
Right.
I'm going to look at the camera here. If you're going to lose a member from your church because you offend them about saying that killing a human being is wrong,
you're not following the commandments.
I think that they either need to be convicted and change their heart to stay, or they need to choose on their own whether to go. But you backing off of that message, Pastor, is the wrong thing to do. It's absolutely wrong. James makes it very clear, not let many of you become teachers because you will incur a stricter judgment. And it is there's no gray area on this issue, that you have a job to do to preach the truth. And if people get offended by that truth and choose to leave, that's their prerogative. You're not there to push them out the door. But when you do not preach the truth, then you're accountable for that. And you can't appease man in the name of God.
I've heard someone say that if you lose members, then you really shouldn't worry about that because you've already lost members by not speaking of abortion.
Amen.
Because those babies, those unborn babies, you've already lost.
That's true. That's true.
So then the other thing, I can't remember what the last thing was that I believe. So basically, if you're not speaking about, you know, being post-abortive, like people, you know, being post-abortive, then that's something that you should be talking about as well, because every single church, and I know that for sure, that every single church has someone that's either been affected by abortion, has coerced somebody into abortion, or has had an abortion themselves.
Right.
So this is something that needs to be talked about, and you know, you're bypassing it, and it just should not happen that way.
Right. And the person, when they do confess their sins, are relieved of that burden too. So then they are being more pastoral if they do help them unload that burden.
Exactly.
You know, and seek forgiveness for such a heavy thing on their souls.
Yeah, I think the thing that kind of boggles my mind, Marlene, is I don't understand why the hesitancy. Why, I get that pastors don't want to be involved in politics, and I get the 501c argument, and I don't agree with any of it, and I think it's all a cop out, it's all an excuse, and yes, we can back that up, but, you know, contact us and we'll help you understand why these are all cop outs, whether it's scripturally or whether it's legally, these things are not legitimate reasons to stay on the bench. But in this case, we're talking about human lives.
Mm-hmm.
And
the
thought that, I think the accusation is that, well, just going and protesting isn't going to make a difference anyways, so why get involved? And I go, well, why would you assume that that's the only thing you could do? I mean, don't get me wrong. I think that the standing outside of the abortion clinics and counseling these young ladies and praying over them does make a difference, first of all. I've done that, you've done that, and we can test that it makes a difference. But why would you assume that that's the only thing you can do? Well, it's because you're looking for another cop-out, right?
Mm-hmm.
There's so much more that can be done. I think one of the things that disturbed me was last year I was in the conversation with somebody from a church, and I was asking them about the Gosnell case.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And it happened right here in Philly.
Right.
And they looked at me and they're like, what are you talking about?
Right, they don't know, yeah.
And I'm thinking, wait a minute, you live less than 80 miles from the epicenter of the largest serial killer that ever existed.
Right.
And the case is in your own backyard, and you don't know what I'm talking
about. It's a helter-skelter of modern day.
And I asked the question, how often does your pastor talk about abortion, or do you discuss abortion in Sunday schools? And, well, we avoid controversial topics.
Yes.
I don't understand why there is this reluctance to take on this issue. This is about human life.
Right.
Any thoughts on that?
I think that's what they're missing, is the value of it.
Right.
You know?
That we ourselves aren't valuing human life as Christians.
We
and so how can a lost world?
I think that, too, when parishioners or people in the church see the horrors of that, or they see abortions, the aftermath, or when I was a kid, I was about 14 or 15 years old, and I was shown that on videos, like videos of trash cans of fetuses. That just affected me for life.
Mm-hmm.
And I think people need to see more of that.
Mm-hmm.
Watching the Gosnell show, you could see there's a movie out about it. And I watched it a couple times. And in fact, the people that were on that show, the investigators, the producers of the show, the majority of them turned pro-life. They were either lukewarm on it or they were pro-choice.
Well, they said that
they converted to
the jurors
too. Christ. Yeah, the jurors also.
Yeah, because the jurors, I think if I remember right, I don't have the exact numbers, but I think like 9 out of the 12were pro-choice.
Yeah,
and
their
three,
hearts were turned.
Right, and they said it was just one thing. They had to watch the abortion procedure.
Right.
Because the prosecution had to make its case for why Gosnell wasn't doing something illegal, because when you compared what he was doing to the abortion procedure.
Right.
But they had to see the abortion procedure for a comparison.
Right.
And as they watched, they were horrified.
Right.
They were watching a human life being taken, and they knew it. Yeah. And they were all, by the time the trial was over, they said that, you know, from what I understand, all 12 jurors had converted to a pro-life position.
Right, yeah. They were horrified, and it affected them.
Yeah, moved their hearts. I believe that truth is irreplaceable. I think that once someone does actually see truth and really get it in their spirit, they totally understand that this is truth, and there's no turning back from that.
The visuals, easier for them to see.
One thing that I mentioned in a recent talk was that I was driving one day and I saw a dead deer on the side of the road. And, you know, I had to turn my head. I couldn't look at it. I was just, you know, really, like, I can never look at anything like that on the road.
Right.
But I remember being out in front of 777 Apple Tree, which is a abortion clinic that, you know, I frequent to try to speak and be the last voice for a woman if they're trying to choose, not choose life for their child. And so I'm standing out there and I'm processing everything. I'm looking at the person out there arguing with someone else. I'm looking at, you know, the fact that there are people at PennDOT across the street in line, standing in line, knowing that this is an abortion clinic that 6,000 babies lose their lives every year, and then I was trying to plead with a man that was going in, and I said, sir, you can bring her out. She doesn't have to stay in there. Like, she can really change her mind. Even at the last minute on the table, she can change her mind. And he said, it's too late. And so I literally, at that moment, like, something just came over me, and it was almost like, not a defeatist moment, but almost like humanity has been defeated.
Right.
Because it's like the fear of not wanting to be a parent or mother, like the fear of standing up and being bold as a pastor, or the fear of you looking at this abortion clinic that has 6,000 babies that die every year and not even, you know, willing to say so. I just started to weep, like really, really cry. And so I guess, you know, what happened was the man came in and pulled back around. I had no idea, because I was crying so hard. I had no idea that he was sitting in front of me in his car. And the woman was in the passenger seat. He was like, tell her what you told me. She had already had the abortion, but I said to him, there's post-abortive help for you.
Yeah.
He said, tell her what you told me. And I could not get myself together to say anything at that moment. So, like, I was trying to, like, suck up my tears. And then I finally, through my tears, was able to tell her that there's post-abortive help for you.
Yeah.
But it did not have to get there.
Yeah.
If we would have stood up.
Right.
Yeah.
You know, so it's just that whole emotional thing of just knowing that Christ died for us, and we can't even be bold enough to stand up for a life that's right there in front of us that can be saved. One life is,
and that life is defenseless.
It's a whole generation.
Yeah.
That's what we're not even seeing.
Right.
You know, we're missing that.
We seem more concerned about the extinction of the bald eagle than we do about our own race.
I remember
dogs,
species.
And cats.
Yeah, I remember when the apostles were flogged for they wouldn't stop sharing the gospel, and after they were flogged, they were released and they rejoiced.
Right,
they considered it a privilege to suffer for Christ's name. Mm-hmm. How far have we fallen from that point that we would consider it a privilege to be critical? We're afraid of offending people or being offended now.
Mm-hmm.
So, if you don't mind me asking a question,
no,
here. So
please.
Some of the common talking points from those who want to justify abortion, you know, it's the mother's body. If you don't have a uterus, you don't have a say, et cetera, et cetera. What are some of the pieces of advice you would give to respond to that? And if you may, I have a couple ideas too. What are some things that you would say to some of these talking points? Which, by the way, if I may say, I find the talking points to be a bit vapid, because once you try to engage in a dialogue with somebody with these talking points, my experience, they got nothing.
Mm-mm.
My experience is that they got to stick to the talking point, because they really can't critically back it up or defend it. Is that your experience also?
The sound bites.
So my experience is that the Holy Spirit has to step in, because I ran a pregnancy center for 4 years. In that sitting in front of all of these women who have different experiences, different situations. Like, you can't just use one talking point to speak to several different women. That's not going to work.
I'm talking more of a...
No, I understand what you're saying.
Yeah, it's a good point.
That's what I'm saying.
Different.
So, with some people, like, you can just talk to them and say, you know, this is a life. You know, this is not your body. This is actually a separate life that's growing inside of you. Other people, you just have to allow God to speak to you to let you know how to guide them.
Sure.
Because He might even tell you not to say anything, to allow them to talk, and then allow them to kind of answer their own question of, you know, what they're thinking of.
If I may add to that, then the one misnomer I think we make as the church is that we think that apologetics is always about trying to convert or persuade the other party.
Mm-hmm.
And when I look at what Christ did with the Pharisees especially, I think He showed us that there's two points to apologetics. One is, I'm trying to persuade you and convert your line of thinking. Mm-hmm. The other one is, quite frankly, I'm trying to discredit you because I know you have no chance of changing your mind, but I need that crowd to stop following you. And so what He would do is He would go up to the Pharisees, and Christ was never trying to convert a Pharisee. Do you ever notice that?
Mm-hmm.
Basically what He was doing was He was discrediting them so that the crowd would stop listening to them and they would listen to Him.
Mm-hmm.
And I think there's room for that in our apologetics too, that as a church today, we need to get over the notion that we're always going to convert somebody. There is power in discrediting this mm-hmm. abortion advocate over here.
Oh, yeah.
And taking apart, dismantling their talking points and showing this crowd over here that those talking points have no valid substance to them,
mm-hmm.
and that they're the talking points that are taking children's lives.
Yeah.
Not because I'm going to convert this person,
right.
But because I'm trying to show this crowd over here. And I think that's something as a church that we need to practice more, because I hear people in the church say all the time, well, you can't mm-hmm. change their mind. You can't change their mind. And I'm
mm-hmm.
saying, well, remember, that's one of the outcomes.
Right.
But when you're taking on somebody like Christ did with a Pharisee, and in this case we'll talk the abortion advocate, it is helpful to discredit what their talking points are so that people can see an alternative truth.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Not
absolutely.
Comfortable, but it's productive.
Yeah.
Right. Yeah, absolutely. Do you find that Susan B. Anthony tries to persuade people in that way?
Well,
when you approach them door to door?
Door to door, we're very careful because we have canvassers that are out there, and, you know, liability purposes, we don't tell them to go out and be argumentative or, you know, just get into any type of thing where they can kind of put themselves in harm's way. Safety's first.
Right.
But if they're in a general conversation, we do encourage that they do talk to people with those talking points so that they can change the hearts and minds.
Right.
So, and we do get a lot of conversations at the door.
Right.
So it's a beautiful thing. Like, I've seen so many people converted, just by the conversation, having a conversation with a young person
right.
about this,
you know,
because it takes away, like, the thought of, you know, I'm debating or I'm, you know, just, but it's a conversation that
right.
you're having.
It makes them more comfortable when they, if they are to go to Planned Parenthood and being there for the girls too.
Yeah.
And you can elaborate more too, Marlene, on how your ambassadors do that you have a system where you actually have people out on the road, and Susan B. Anthony organization pays these ambassadors, isn't that thing, like,
the
to go door to door.
The representatives go door to door, and as I was saying before, they knock on the doors and talk to people about late-term abortion and infanticide, what's happening
right.
now, and then we also talk about the candidates that are running. So of
right.
course, we know that we have some extreme candidates that are running for
right.
office, John Fetterman and Josh Shapiro.
Right.
So it's
that's
really
our battle in PA.
Yeah, and they're in Pennsylvania, and it's.
But if someone in the audience wants to have that job, they can go on to.
Mm-hmm.
You want to give them your website so you can.
Of course.
Have them go on and sign up for that.
Yes, yeah, SusanBAnthonyList.org.
List
SBAList.org.
Yeah, SBAList.org is the website, and on there you can see a drop down for We Are Hiring, or if you
mm-hmm.
want to be a representative, and then you can contact.
Right, and we pay $15 an hour, and we also 15. Have bonuses as well.
So. And you pay for, am I right, you pay for mileage?
Mileage,
too?
30 cents a mile.
And you have training prior to them going out and on the road and doing
pay
that.
Training. And we do, you know, train as long as they need to be trained, and we make sure that they're comfortable.
So. Yeah, so if you're anyone's inclined to do that, please get on the website and contact Susan B. Anthony and sign up to do that type of work, because between now and November, we're going to need a lot of help in changing hearts and minds to elect candidates that will not bring abortion to Pennsylvania. Right. We'll make it unlawful.
Right, and so far across Pennsylvania, we've knocked on 250,000 doors so far, and our target goal is a half a million. So,
half a million by election?
By election.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, that would be great. Yeah. So, if anybody wants to get involved again, please go on that website and check it out. And Rick, you want to tell us how Kinetic Faith can, how we can.
Yeah, so just real quick observation about the importance of this next election. You know, we always think that this next election is the most important. I'd like to remind people that in the case of abortion right now, neither side is interested in maintaining the status quo. Mm-hmm. If you look at the pro-life side, we obviously want to end abortion. But if you look at those who advocate for abortion and take these lives, they're no longer wanting abortion as it has existed for the last 20 some 34 years. Yeah. They're wanting to take it to a whole new level where children are being killed as they're being born.
Right.
There's some really radical things that are coming about here. So this is a very serious battle against evil that we need to get engaged with and take very seriously, because this is not even about the status quo anymore. This is evil at a whole new level.
Absolutely. Right. Yeah. I'm glad you brought that up.
Yeah.
Thank you. That is what's happening right now.
And as far as Kinetic Faith goes, we are gearing up, as you know, for a series of conferences. We want to go across the state, and we're taking it to the churches. We're going to go into communities, and we're going to start hosting conferences and inviting church audiences and educating them on the fact that interposition is something that we have a responsibility to love our neighbor and do.
Right.
And to clarify, what we mean by interposition in this case is it is literally being salt and light. Salt preserves, light chases away darkness. And I say, how are we doing? Mm-hmm. How are we doing? We're not doing very good, right?
No.
So if you look at a community's tolerance level for evil, our communities are tolerating way too much evil, which means that we have not been very influential.
What's Edmund
and
Burke
so,
say?
What's that?
What does Edmund Burke say?
Oh, yes. All that's necessary for evil to succeed is for good men to do nothing.
Right.
And we like to tag a line onto the back of that that says, and how long can you do nothing and still call yourself a good man?
Right?
And that's our message to the churches right now, is that you cannot stand by and just watch this and shake your head and wag your finger.
Right.
You have to get involved. That's our calling, to be salt and light. And that at the end of the day, if we're being honest, it's our comfort level that we're more worried about. It's our sensibilities. We're more concerned about our comfort being disrupted in this fight and our skin in the game, which is not what Christ ever wanted us to do. He wanted us to, you know, in Hebrews 12:4, you know, it calls on us to be willing to confront the sin of society to the point where we put ourselves at our own peril.
Right.
When Jesus said, take up that cross and follow me, it wasn't like just a slogan.
Right.
He meant be prepared to go that far.
Yeah. It's not a Nike commercial, just do it.
Correct, exactly. And so our message is to the churches that that we have, quite frankly, we have a culpability for why the state of society is in the way it's in, and we have a responsibility to do something about it. But we're not there to beat people up. We're there to say, listen, this is the truth in love. We're here to walk this road with you. We're here to train you, we're here to equip you, and we're here to mobilize you. We're here to walk this road with you and show you that you can have success in convincing communities to battle evil. We've had success over the past 3 years. You know, we've helped communities that were trying to fight issues with the school boards, you know, whether it's CRT, whether it's transgenderism, the bathrooms, whether it's the issue with drag queen story hour at libraries, whether it's election fraud, whether it's the forced vaccinations and mandates that were shutting people down and preventing them from putting food on their table. Like, all of these are issues of moral depravity that we need to confront.
Right.
And so we've helped train, equip, and mobilize teams across the state to take these issues on, and we've got a track record that shows that when people work together and when they're ready to on behalf of their neighbor interpose, they can win. They can beat back the gates of hell.
Right, yep. Right.
So speaking of that, how would you, and I guess this would be a good topic to talk about, because I'm sure that a lot of people are, you know, everybody is not as bold as us, I would say. How would you tell them to stand up to, you know, just the threats that might be coming towards them, yeah, or being bold in their faith?
So I'll address the issue first about not everyone's as courageous as we are and things like that. When we've worked with people that have never spoken in front of school boards, for instance, mm-hmm, there will be people that will be like, well, I can't do what you do, Rick. I mean, you can dismantle these people. And I say, well, first of all, you got to be who you are. Mm-hmm. And I coach them that first time you speak in front of that, just find your voice and find your courage. Next time, get back up there and do it again. Next time, and we coach them and we through these things, and we find that after four or five times doing this, mm-hmm, guess what they do? They find that courage. Yeah. Courage is contagious.
And even people that are afraid just to go in front of Planned Parenthood.
That's right.
For fear of being intimidated by that situation.
That's right. Yeah. You just bring them in incrementally and you show them. You mm-hmm show them in baby steps. Mm-hmm. But here's what you got to do.
Face your fear.
In love, you have to tell them that that's not what I want of you. That's mm-hmm what Christ expects of you.
Yes.
That when you took on his name, with that came the responsibility mm-hmm of carrying your cross.
Right.
And so you don't have the luxury of saying, I'm not courageous like you, Rick. I'm not, mm-hmm, I can't do what you do, Marlene. Right. That's no longer an out.
All we can do is pray.
When you take on the mantle of Christ.
And
exactly.
Prayer is good, of course.
Well, you know what's funny about the prayer? I find, and I don't mean to offend anybody, we take prayer very seriously in our groups.
Right.
But you'll never see us have a call to action card that asks people to pray for us. We have call to action cards of people to get involved,
right,
and
mm-hmm
then of those that get involved, mm-hmm, then we'll ask them to be prayer warriors,
right,
because Christians are using prayer as an out now.
Right.
Oh, I'll pray for you. But what they're doing is they're basically saying, right, I don't have to do anything now,
or
right?
Or have you heard of this? They say, well, let me pray about it first.
Yeah, let me pray about it first. You got to pray about wanting to save babies' lives?
It might be too late by the time they get
that. You need to pray about which way you get involved, but you need to pray about whether to get involved, right? Yeah, you're absolutely right. So first of all, you have to show people that courage is an expectation, but you can get there over time. The second thing we do is we show them that it doesn't matter what Chris thinks. It doesn't matter what Marlene thinks. It doesn't matter what Rick thinks. What matters mm-hmm is, can we work and play well together in a mm-hmm way that we show unity so that we can make a persuasive argument to the community?
Exactly.
And if we're being honest, that's really our weakness on the right. We don't work together well, do we?
Right.
And so what we do is we spend a lot of time with our teams teaching them about team unity and resolve and working together and functioning as, mm-hmm, as a unit, mm-hmm, and then how to make those arguments that draw in volunteers, how to support them in such a way that their team doesn't feel like they're being overworked. Mm-hmm. And once you start to get a team, get some traction and start working together, and the people in the community have identified a group that they can go to for mm-hmm answers, mm-hmm, that's powerful. That's so powerful.
Yeah.
And that's what we're really, that's why I say it's a crying shame that the church is missing this opportunity, because here's one thing that we haven't really talked about yet. We're sending people away from the church for answers.
Mm-hmm. Right.
These teams should be emanating from these churches, because
that's
people
right
should be coming to the church for answers.
Right.
And when you look at all the issues of today, LGBT issues, abortion issues, sexual identity issues, you look at the fraud and the corruption issues, who's coming to churches for answers?
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And it isn't because, you know, it isn't because I have people that want to come to churches for answers, but the churches are not getting involved, and it's by de facto they're pushing people away to find answers somewhere else, and that's a crying shame.
Yeah.
God meant for people to be able to come to us for answers. 1 Corinthians 6, for instance, the whole issue of not taking each other to court, that it's been kind of manipulated that we shouldn't take each other to court because we love each other. Well, that's great, but actually Paul's apologetic for why we shouldn't take each other to court in 1 Corinthians 6 is that our level of thinking as Christians is supposed to be high enough that mm-hmm people come and look to us for answers.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Yeah. You know, right. And that's what we need to get. We need to up our games and work together so that the communities can find answers in us as a church.
Right.
Is that fair?
I totally agree with that, and I love the fact that you mentioned unity, because that is actually, you know, because Christ calls us to have one mind,
right?
Like to have his mind, And to
but his mind is tough to, because you got to give up our mind, right?
Right.
So that's where
it's
the disunity
comes
in.
It's all about surrender. Like, because we surrender our will for his.
Can I just offer one word of encouragement about that unity issue?
Yeah.
So those of you who out there that have been fighting the fight and people accuse you of disunity or being a divider, I want to encourage you with Jude 19. Jude 19 makes very clear, it says, these are the ones who are the dividers. Look it up, Jude 19, it says, these are the ones who are the dividers. Those are who are worldly minded, devoid of the Spirit. So when somebody wants to accuse you of being a divider because you're trying to help save babies' lives, just ask them, which one of us is more worldly minded? The one who wants to save the baby's life or the one who doesn't? Because the real dividers are the ones who are worldly minded, who are giving into the world, who are trying to appease the world, not the ones who are holding the line for Christ. Those are not the dividers.
Right. Well, that's very true. Very true. So I guess we can wrap it up with Rick, you raised four boys. What are your what were your goals in raising them to be the men they are today?
Well, like I said, you know, I said my job is to put myself out of a job, right?
Right.
And so we had a saying in our house was that you're not a man when you're dependent. You're not a man when you're independent. You become a man when you're dependable. So my job was to make them dependable, so their wife and kids could depend on them. And everything I did was around that. You know, when I think about the key things dads can do to make a difference in this, first of all, one of the things I taught my boys on, and they'd roll their eyes if they were here because they're tired of hearing these slogans and stuff, but they'll also admit that it had this effect on them. And the first one was, as you raise your sons and daughters, it's important that they know that you have authority over you as a father. Like, my sons knew that there was authority over me. Every child wants to grow up to be like their dad or their mom, right? Well, if I say the buck stops with me, I'm teaching my kids to be rebellious because they're just going to be their own God. But when I taught them about law and order, and I taught them about living under the authority of God, who's the ultimate authority of which all other authority emanates, there was that was a check and balance there, that there's a masculinity that has power in it. I always said that masculinity was like electricity. If it's in the form of a lightning bolt, it can be destructive. If it's channeled through conduit, it can light up the home, your home. And that's what masculinity is. So you must have authority over you. The second thing was what I call offensive parenting. Offensive parenting is, you know, defense is when you say, don't do this, don't do that. Offensive parenting is when you're teaching your kids to do the right thing and they're so focused on making sure they don't get in trouble for not doing the right thing, they don't have time to get in trouble with other things. And then the third thing was working together. We really emphasize vacations and fun time together, but I don't think that we emphasize enough that families need to work together. And when a father takes a role on to direct their children on a project and to roll up his sleeves with them and get the mom on board.
Their hands dirty.
Get their hands dirty and work in that soil or work on that that construction project. That it builds a cohesiveness in that family unit. And there's and so when your kids get in trouble, they do feel like they can talk to you now.
Right.
Your teenage daughter gets pregnant or your son gets a girl pregnant. The family that's been doing that, working together, the family that's been teaching offensive parenting to do the right thing, the parents that have said that there's authority over us, so therefore there's authority over you, son or daughter, they're more likely that their kids can come back and talk to them about things. My kids talk to me about these things all the time.
Right.
And it's powerful.
Yeah. Yeah.
Work hard as a father to lead and lead in an active way. And there was another thing that I always used to do, I think I said before, which was we never asked our sons, what would a Christian do? We would always ask them, what would a Christian young man do? And I would encourage that with mothers and fathers of daughters too. What would a Christian young lady do? I think reinforcing these things builds into their psyche an ability to reaffirm the identity that God gave them and give them a moral compass so that in the moment of truth, they're more likely to do the right thing.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. Marlene, you have two daughters. What would your advice be to raising daughters? I don't have daughters. I have two sons, so we're...
I'm taking notes because I didn't have daughters.
You have any granddaughters, Rick?
I have a granddaughter now, yeah.
Yeah, so the advice to, I guess when I think about it is that I don't feel like I was the perfect parent.
None of us are.
Thank God. I thought I was the only one.
But even throughout my weaknesses, even throughout the flaws that they've seen over the years, the things that I've walked through as a parent who's not perfect or not a perfect person, of course, is that they saw the redemption
right.
that took place when I surrendered my life to Christ. And so I know that that's something, even if they don't take hold of it right now, it's something that they will never forget. And I believe that that's going to be something that that's going to continue to bring them to Christ, you know, in the end.
Right.
I think that that is just a beautiful thing, just seeing it firsthand. Because I think telling a child, you know, this is the way you should go, that's the first step. But actually
right.
doing what you are supposed to do as a woman in Christ,
right.
as a parent in Christ, that's something totally different, you know.
Right.
And I think you can either lead a child to you or draw a child away by the way that you react to how Christ has shown you.
Right. And that is good, because children don't need a parent to be narcissistic and self-consumed.
Mm-hmm.
They need a parent to know, like you said, you have a higher authority above you.
Yeah.
And that there is, you know, a Heavenly Father as well, too, to take the reins at times.
And being able to say that, you know, you're sorry and that you
right,
were
wrong. You're
humble. And you know, just humble yourself, because you are not the only factor here. Children
right.
have a say-so as well.
Right,
so
right.
we just have to really respect them.
Right, well. It's so powerful, right? When children see how moms and dads interact and they see their parents mess up and they see their parents make things right,
mm-hmm.
you're setting a great example for them to follow. I mean, and every parent's messed up, but the fact that they would say, again, because of that authority over me, I need to make this right, that's powerful.
Right,
absolutely.
Right. And again, it's SBA List, L-I-S-T, .org or .com?
.org
to sign up to do this type of work. And if you are so inclined to do it or afraid, then we have Kinetic Faith, who will help you mobilize and organize to get your church groups out to go to Planned Parenthood
right.
or to go before your legislators or your governor to protest or to ask them to vote
pro-life. Persuade your community. That's
persuade
really
your community.
Yes, to be salt
talk
and
to your groups at church in the supermarket, wherever. You know, I just had my former pastor this afternoon. He said to me, I hire these people to do heating and cooling work for me. And you know what they asked me? This man came up to me in my face and he said, do you know Christ? And he's like taken aback, because of course he does. He's a preacher. He's a saintly type guy. You know?
Yeah.
So it's like getting out there, and even though you're just a customer or you're mm-hmm. working for someone, you have to get in their face, so to speak.
We got to be salt and light wherever we go.
Salt and light, right. And even, and he says, you know, he let him on. He says, why do you ask? He says, because it's important. And, you know, Eric knew that it was
Well, because
important.
You actually love people. I mean,
right.
you're concerned. This is,
right.
So it's heart cancer. You got cancer of the heart.
Right.
And we have the cure for heart cancer. Why mm-hmm. would
why
we
would
really
hold
be,
it?
Would
withhold
we, re-
it.
Would we be really loving you if we withheld that?
Right.
That cure?
Yeah. Right. Why would you suppress medication when, you know, or
That's right.
a cure?
Yeah.
So it's kineticfaith.org.
Kineticfaith.org, K-I-N-E-T-I-C.
And you can get in touch with us. We'll have different conferences over the summer, and we'll have that publicized. And for future shows, we'll have some legislators on, some candidates, so you can explore who is running for office. And I thank you for listening.
Thanks for having us. That was great. It's great being with you guys tonight. Thank
always,
you.
Always.
God bless. Thank you.
God bless.
Yeah, you know, we all have our jobs, so we all have to be salt and light. So go and be salt and light, and we'll be with you again in a month. Thank you.
Pro Life Berks on BCTV is underwritten by Tom Schaefer RV Superstore.